pretty kindly offered to answer a few questions for say 5 or 10 minutes. So if anyone does have any other questions, okay, I saw one just there.
That's a very good question. Can people hear the questions? Yeah. So I think we're looking at this at the moment, and one of the problems with current research is that it's sort of circular because people study diagnosed girls and women, and they're of course diagnosed by current criteria that may be biased towards males. I think there's a genuine gender discrepancy, probably biologically, because almost every neurodevelopmental disorder is more common in males than females, and I think there's something about the speed of development in utero probably makes males somewhat more vulnerable than other genetic factors. But I think we are underestimating the numbers of women and girls with autism. And I think that's for a number of reasons. We still, most of our autism research is based on male sample. And because we used to think that it was 10 to 1, we've often systematically excluded women from research. So we're working with biased data, and what we think we know about autism is actually what we know about male autism. Secondly, in the public imagination, and even clinical and parents' imagination, autism is associated with males. And so if you see a girl who's socially awkward, you probably think she's socially anxious or shy. If you see a boy who's socially awkward, you might think, is it autism? And so I think that at every stage, from parental recognition to GPs, teachers, I think it affects at every stage. And then there's a question about whether autism looks different in women. So there's some indication that rigid and repetitive behavior may be slightly less obvious, that special interests may more often fall in neurotypical areas. So girls, you know, are passionate about horses, a girl with autism, or a boy band. Unless the clinician digs a bit deeper to find out, they just collect facts about these things in a very narrow way, it's not going to look atypical. Whereas if a boy says, you know, I collect photos of electricity pylons, then that probably again lifts a red flag. So I think those are some of the reasons, and we do know that often there's diagnostic overshadowing. So a girl with undiagnosed autism will get referred for an eating disorder. If the clinician stops and doesn't dig deeper and see it's an eating disorder in the context of autism, then you stop with a presenting disorder, and that's a problem because the type of intervention is going to be different if you know the context of autism.
Very much. She was great. Maybe this is a bit of a strange question, I'm not sure, Andy, but so you characterise sexual autism as talent. I wondered whether we could think the other way around to some extent, where maybe you might imagine perceptual talent possibly might lead to some of the aspects of autism that could be observed.
It's certainly a possibility, and I think the kind of predictive coding Bayesian accounts that are coming out now are really exciting, and potentially would tell that kind of story, I think. Not exactly that autism grows out of talent, but that autism and talent share something different about how the brains are predictable when you're working in autism. The difficulty I have with those accounts at the moment is that they're almost too broad. So they don't necessarily allow us to see the kind of fine cuts of unusual but also intact pattern of abilities in autism. And I'm a bit leery of those theories that sort of say, well, social is most effective because social is the hardest thing we do. I don't think we have a metric to prove that on. But I do think, yes, there's certainly a road to go that way. And I think it's exciting work. And the more that those Bayesian accounts can move from simply explaining what's already been demonstrated and instead prompt new demonstrations and have new predictions for novel kinds of demonstrations, I think we're moving to a very exciting phase.
Am I right in thinking that DSM-5 has taken out a lot of the kind of subcategories like Asperger's? But the way you describe autism, it seems to be a very modular thing. So surely that's almost the wrong direction
go.
I just wondering what your thoughts on that.
So DSM-5 did collapse autistic disorder, as it was called, and Asperger's disorder, and pervasive developmental disorder, not otherwise specified, into one autism spectrum. And there are lots of reasons for that. but just to highlight one in relation to the modular aspect, Asperger's was being defined as autism without language impairment and without intellectual impairment. Language impairment and intellectual impairment aren't part of the criteria for autism, so you kind of, there's no logic there. So the fact that you can find social difficulties without routine repetitive behavior isn't actually helped by Asperger's syndrome. What it probably reflects is what was found was that PDD-NOS was meant to be a very small little way to catch people who didn't quite meet autism. And it turned out, at least in the States, it was used maybe 10 times as often as autistic disorders used. So everyone was being put in this catch-all category where everybody didn't quite meet for different reasons. But I suspect that reflects the fact that you can sometimes have one part without another. And it turned out the nail in the coffin for keeping these separate categories was Kathy Lord's work showing that in really expert diagnostic centers in the States, the best predictor of which diagnosis you came out with, Asperger's, autism, or PDNOS, wasn't any characteristic of you. It was which door you went through, which clinic you went through. So everyone thought they knew what Asperger's meant, but actually there wasn't any agreement. So instead, it would seem more sensible to have a spectrum where the individual is described in terms of their language impairment or skills and their intellectual impairment or skills. So I think it's slightly orthogonal to the fractionated triad thought, but I think there is a relationship. You know? It's a very good question. So I was taught when I was a PhD student that autism happened all over the world, affected all populations at the same frequency, but in fact that was just claim. In fact, there's a real paucity of good autism research, particularly in low and middle income countries. So there are studies, epidemiological studies in the US, in the UK, in the Scandinavian countries, in Japan, but people only now are beginning to do work in Africa, in India, in Russia, in enormous populations that are being neglected. And it's a real irony that 90% of the autism research is done in these high-income countries, and 90% of people with autism live in low-income countries. So it's a really pressing need. From what has been studied, for example, culture like Japan that is quite different, autism looks remarkably the same. But we do need much more research, and you're right that absolutely what counts as neurotypical social behavior will be different in different places. It's just that autism is defined by being different from that. And the value given to different kinds of interests and different kinds of behavior, I'm sure, will be very, very different.
Hi. I was just wondering,
Kathy,
you mentioned bipolar disorder.
Mm. I don't know of any demonstrated link between bipolar disorder and autism. I mean, there may be, it's not one of the things, genetically, for example, some of the same genes seem to be popping up as relevant for schizophrenia and for autism, which is interesting and kind of complicated. I don't know of links, although obviously, correct me, with bipolar. I mentioned bipolar because there is this idea that bipolar disorder may also have a higher rate of talents, particularly kind of artistic talents, not maybe memory and maths, but art and music, and that there it's sometimes difficult to pull apart whether it's just being enormously productive. If you're in a manic phase and you stay up all night drawing or painting or writing, if you're a good artist, that's going to be a fantastic flourishing of art. Of course, if you're a bad artist, it's still going to be a lot of art, but just not necessarily very good. So it's not clear that the mania makes you a better artist, it may just make you more productive.
To myths around autism, but there's all sorts online. Is there anything that comes to mind around myths and what we should be considering?
Yeah, I suppose that there are so many, or there have been so many. I mean, the psychogenic, the refrigerator mother myth was maybe one of the most harmful. The idea that you could make your child autistic by being a cold and a loving mother, and that's what the cause of autism was. And although in this country, I think, you know, I hope no parent has been told that, there are countries, including France, where parents are told that, you know, something about their parenting that's really, or something about how they felt about the child in the womb that caused their child's autism. So that's pretty harmful. Of course, the vaccine scare was a myth that's caused a great deal of harm. And then there are more everyday myths, and still there are GPs who think that if a child makes eye contact, that means it can't be autism. So, you know, there are all kinds of myths. And maybe the myth that we think that, you know, autism doesn't affect many women, we'll look back on that. And actually, more recently, as Jeff and Alice have shown, that, you know, the idea that autism is a problem of empathizing or of empathy, I think is a complete myth. And that's a hard one to shift.
Okay. I'm sorry, sir. Yeah.
Within that dynamic picture of development of special ability, do we know anything about the role of comorbidity within that?
Very interesting. Actually, there's a undergraduate working with some moment who's interested in exactly that question. What's the relationship between mental health and well-being and talent? I think I don't know of any work on that, except this recent report that having a special interest is good for well-being in autism, good for quality of life. But no, we're going to look at that, but at the moment I don't know anything. It's a very interesting question.
Yeah, one last question.
Well, I think we talk to people like Pam and Adam Oppelford, who work very much on drawing out musical talent and musical interest and working with musical interest to get that to a point where it's something the child can really enjoy and move forward with. And expose the child to lots of different sorts of stimulation and stimuli, you know, so that they have a chance to find things that they are moved by and interested in. It's still a mystery why some children and adults fasten on one thing. We all have calendars in front of us. Why do, maybe Richard can answer this, why do some children and adults, mainly with autism, but sometimes without, fix on spotting the regularities between day and date? Why don't we all do it? If we have it in front of us. Why do we all generate regularities in grammar without any effort, but we're not doing these other kinds of things? So I think it is a mystery why some people develop obvious talents and others don't. But I think it's also worth bearing in mind that hidden underneath that eye for detail that may only be causing distress, there is a potential for an eye for detail that could be really of advantage to the child.
Okay, so we'll wrap the question portion up now. Only leaves me to say a huge thank you to both Francesca and Pamela for sharing their thoughts with us, and another round of applause. And I'd like to extend an invitation to everyone to join us for wine and nibbles just outside the way if you have any more burning questions.